And so smart basing is not necessarily just in the Air Force or the Space Force. It is a Defense Department-wide endeavor, correct?
Yeah, it is a Defense Department-wide endeavor. The Air Force has an interesting challenge because our bases are our force projection platforms. And so we have to think about them differently from how we operate our missions there, and how we, you know, conduct things like our, you know, kind of vital space mission and our Air Force maintenance and logistics operations. And so there are a great number of things for us that are really more deeply tied into the mission when we think about smart bases.
So what do you think predicated this shift from what I'll call dumb bases to this focus on smart bases?
So I think a lot of it is technology here is really acting like it's really kind of creating a pressure valve to push these things forward, right? You know, we have a new generation of very tech literate airmen and guardians, right? When you have an 18-year-old who shows up, you know, they don't want to be on, you know, a heavy brick laptop or being, you know, unable to move back and forth between, you know, the flight line and the depot, right? It makes sense to have like, oh, you know, we have a tablet that we can work on, you know, order parts immediately from the depot down the road. We want to be able to make sure that we have up-to-date training, right? So a lot of it is the possibility of what's available in commercial technologies and how other similar industries in airlines and maintenance and logistics, how those industries are being revolutionized by technology and really allowing us to leverage a lot of kind of our national innovations to make it a more efficient place to move, to be able to work and to be able to execute. We are, as a nation, we are up against you know, adversaries that have, in some cases, physically larger forces, right? And so, you know, the efficiency that you're able to produce by having smart connected bases with the right infrastructure in places, it is massive. And it's an obvious way to get more out of our force without really, you know, pushing people sort of individually, right? To be able to allow, and you see this through ITAS, you see this through other efforts where a lot of the focus of the force of the future are to think of things, what are the things that only the military can do? What are the things that technology can do? What are the things that you don't want to have, you know, you don't want to have an airman running around patching systems or running cable when you can have either an automated system or some contract to do that. So it is a rethinking of what the military specific jobs in the military are.
DoD officials have set upon themselves a 2027 deadline for zero trust implementation, or a degree of it at least. Do you think that's realistic? Can it be done in that time frame?
It will depend on how you define zero trust. And so if you could get to 2027 realistically if you put a bunch of asterisks next to it, right? You said for critical applications, you know, and you've gone far enough, right? So zero trust is a constant evolution of things. There's no defined endpoint. You'll always be able to tighten things up and fix your processes more, and, you know, better segment your network and better understand, your cyber posture, right? So the way that I think about cyber defense is, or kind of cyber risk, is the gap between what you know and understand and reality, right? And so when you know, as we go through the zero trust maturation, we're going to be learning more and more about reality. We're going to be refactoring applications. We're going to be setting infrastructure. We're going to be creating better common services. We're going to get more people into those common services that provide more of that underlying baseline. And so we will get there. We will have capabilities there. Will it be enough? I mean, it will have to be, and we are late to need. So I believe that we will get there. We will have the right services available. And then, as with all things inside of a gigantic enterprise, it will be prioritizing where we need to close that information gap most, right? Critical weapon systems, you know, critical platforms for the Air Force, critical locations. And then there will be that long tail, you know, as various technology life cycles hit, you know, tools and business systems and and kind of our legacy elements that will force that update to a baseline which has more zero trust principles as an architectural imperative baked into them. So we will get there, but it will, you know, we tell people all the time, right? Like this is a 10 to 15 year journey, which in the military is two to five leadership changes, right? And so we're all going to have the stamina to be able to carry this message when you're not the first one and you're not the last one, right? And so we're on a really long journey here that's going to have to continue past us. And so we have to just consider the longevity of the effort and not get fatigue on the zero trust message.